So, hi everyone, welcome to the session. I'm Rajshekar, I work as a developer evangelist for Microsoft. In this session, we're going to very quickly look at some best practices for writing JavaScript, which is asynchronous JavaScript, right? So that's briefly the agenda. So we'll see why this is important, why we should be worried about async, and especially from a JavaScript perspective. We'll review what are some of the problems doing asynchronous development today, and then we'll take a look at a couple of approaches for implementing asynchronous web applications using a couple of techniques, a couple of frameworks, libraries that are out there. So, one is called as Promises, another is a library called RxJS, which is a very interesting interesting library. So with that, let's see why is this something that's important? Why should we worry about this, right? If you look at it today, asynchrony is it's kind of the order of the day today, right? How many of you have heard of a C++ guru? His name is Herb Sutter. How many of you have heard of Herb Sutter? So we have a few C++ people there. That's good. So Herb Sutter is this C++ expert who sits on the C++ standards body. He's part of the standards process and all that. So I think about 3-4 years back, he wrote a landmark paper called "The Free Lunch Is Over." Now what he meant by that was, for a very long time, if you look at processor technology, right, it would just keep getting faster and faster and faster, right? And we have heard of the Moore's law and whatnot. As application developers, we really didn't have to, perhaps not worry about performance quite as much, right? I mean, I can write bad code, it probably runs very slowly now. 6 months later, it's going to run faster anyway, right? It's not, you don't have to worry about it. Just throw more hardware at it, it'll get better. Now, we got to a point where, we started hitting physical limits where you just can't make processors any faster, right? Now we have multiple cores, now, you get machines with more and more processors, right? The count of processors increasing. So as app developers, this means that, we have to introduce some changes into the way we make applications. We just can't rely on the hardware getting better and better. Hardware is getting better, but in a different way, right? If you want to leverage it, it means that you have to write your applications slightly differently, right? You have to start writing applications that leverage multiple cores, multiple CPUs, and so on. So, so that's what I mean by no more free lunch, right? You don't get better performance for free, right? Fast and fluid interfaces, are really kind of, critical for web applications today, right? Gone are the days when people would put up with web interfaces which took forever to load, which was not responsive. You hit a button, maybe it worked, maybe it not work. Not happening anymore. We want, web interfaces which respond to user interaction, right? Especially on, for example, mobile devices, right? If you're where you are, really operating in a constrained environment, you want your app to run fast, right? To be responsive. Many of the HTML5 APIs that you see coming out are, async APIs, right? For example, IndexedDB, WebSockets, right? Pretty much any API, geolocation, any API that does I/O, right, that does input output with some device, the API is asynchronous, right? Why is that? Again, user experience is the key there, right? You don't want to make a call to some API, some browser subsystem, and have that call just, take forever to return, and your browser just, user interface just hangs while that happens, right? That's a poor user experience. Leveraging multiple cores, as I was saying earlier. The basic principle is, if you have I/O and CPU intensive code in your app, delegate that to spare cores or background processes, and so on. The thing about asynchrony is, if you don't like it, bad for you, get used to it. That's what we're gonna have in the future, right? The good news is, there are the libraries and the frameworks are catching up, right? So we are getting frameworks and libraries, which kind of make this easier to do. Traditionally, the problem with doing asynchronous development is that it's hard to do, right? If you want to create applications which are multi-threaded, you have a zillion things to worry about, right? If you have shared state, good luck with, maintaining integrity of your data which is shared across your multiple threads and whatnot. In this session, we'll be looking at a couple of those approaches, couple of frameworks. If you look at JavaScript per se, right, there are some issues with asynchronous development as it is today. It has this tendency to turn your control flow inside out. Now, how many of you have done Ajax development? So, all of you. So, how does it work, right? So, you create your XML HTTP request, you set async to true, you create a handler for your on ready state, and then when this thing comes back, you do something in response to it. Now, if you notice, this is very different from synchronous development, right? Where you have step one, step two, step three, your control flow is just, you know, one step after another. Here, you have a case where a few things happen, and then, you know, the continuation, right? The next step is going to happen at some point in the future, right? It's not a contiguous flow. This makes it hard. So if you, you know, managing state can get hard. Handling errors can get harder, right? So how do you cleanly handle errors? In JavaScript, of course, you can do try and catch, right? But if it's an asynchronous call, that means that the handler, especially if you use anonymous, you know, implied functions and so forth, your callbacks will get called sometime in the future. Your try catches are going to have no effect on that callback, right? So which means if you have callbacks, you're going to have try catches and error handling in every single callback. So if you're doing something in sequence, let's say I'm making a call to a Twitter service in response, once I get the response back, I'm doing something with Facebook, and you know, then I make a call to IndexedDB, and then I go to a geolocation, you know, just a convoluted scenario. If you're doing all of these, you know, then you can imagine, you know, how you can get lost in, you know, a bunch of callbacks. So the two frameworks that we look at today are going to kind of deal with, or kind of help you deal with some of these problems. The first one is promises. So the best way to talk about promises is to show you how it works. So it's going to be difficult. So I'm going to keep this down and talk really loud. Alright, so I have a couple of demos here that I kind of want to quickly show you. So, what I have here is, okay, let's first look at the tweet sample. And I hope the internet works here. Let me show you the code. Hope the internet works here. Alright, good, it works. So basically, all that's happening here is just, you know, making a Twitter API call and looking for a hashtag called JS2, and that's the Twitter activity that's happening right now. Yep, I agree with that. I'll talk by Rakesh. I'll just turn this off. So let's see what really happened there, right? So, you know, that's the nothing major. So I just have a table. I use jQuery templates to populate that table. But the key piece is over here, right? I'm calling a method called get on an object called tweets, and I'm doing something interesting here. So let me just show you what tweets does. So that's just a script that I put together here. Very simple. So it's just a regular object, you know, tweets, and has a method called get, and I'm just using jQuery to, you know, make the AJAX request. So I do that. I mean, all this is standard stuff, right? In on success, you know, I handle the data that I get back from the Twitter service. Now, how does this communication actually work? So traditionally, what we'd have done is, you know, my API I would have probably written it like this, right? I would have said, you know, I would have put a callback there, and then probably, you know, I would have done something like CV of data, right? So now when I say, you know, tweets.get, I'll pass a callback function to tweets.get, and inside that callback function, I'll, you know, go ahead and do the processing, do the UI. Now here it's slightly different, right? Now that's not how it's working here. So what have I done here? Here I've used an object called as a promise, right? So promise is basically an abstraction that, it's just basically an abstraction around a callback, right? It basically represents a continuation. It represents some piece of code that needs to execute at some point in the future. So what am I doing? I'm creating a promise here, and I'm returning that promise object from my get method, right? And within my error and success handlers, what I do is I just call resolve or error on my promise object. So this is the API for generating or handling callbacks. Now when I say resolve, I'm hoping that whoever is interested in getting tweets, they will get notified of it. So if you look at the client code, this is what it looks like, right? So I say tweets.get, and then I say .10, right? And then I pass a callback there, and I handle that. And then I have a header handling it. Now the interesting thing here is, if you is that promises allow you to basically escape from nested callback hell, right? So here, let's say what I want to do is I want to get these tweets, show it on the screen. Maybe I want to take it and put it onto an IndexedDB database, right? Which is again an asynchronous call. So now what you can do is you can say tweets.get and say then and do your processing there. And then you can notice that you can use, it's like a fluid syntax. Now I can say on top of that, I can continue that. I can say dot then again and pass another callback where I do something else. So here perhaps I'll go ahead and use a IndexedDB API and then save it to my IndexedDB. And then I can keep going like that, right? I can say then and do the next thing. So basically the promise framework kind of takes care of making sure that your callbacks are executed in the correct sequence, right? So that takes care of nested callbacks, right? You don't have to worry about callbacks inside callbacks. Another thing that it allows you to do is error handling, right? So how do you do error handling? I mean, you might think that this still doesn't solve the error handling problem, right? I still have to go and say try and all this stuff, right? I probably in each callback have to do that. Now, it turns out the promise framework has an elegant solution for that as well. What you can do is, instead of doing, there are a couple of approaches. Here, what I've done is in the first call, I have passed an error handler to the first callback itself. So when I say then, I pass second parameter as another function where I do error handling. But here, the issue with this approach is, this handles only errors which occur in that particular asynchronous call, right? If my tweet API call fails, then I have a handler. But what if the attempt to save to the IndexedDB fails? Let's say here I do something else, and if that fails, does that mean that I have to pass an error handler for every single client call? So here I have to pass another error handler, here I have to pass another error handler, and so on and so forth, which is probably not very ideal. It turns out that the promises framework allows you to do something like this. I can say dot error and pass a handler right at the end, right? And then do my error handling here. So this is not required. So you can see how this is very similar to your try catch, right? So it's like you can imagine all these steps as being part of a try block, and then the final error is being part of the exception handling block. So in this case, what happens is all of these would run. If any of those asynchronous calls fail, your error handler is going to get called directly. So it might look like magic, right? How is all this happening? The key to understand here is that all of these steps get executed in one shot, right? As in, when the script engine is running, is executing this one line, it's just one line of code, right? I just put it in multiple lines, but it's just one line of code. Tweets.get, that gives you a promise object, and I'm saying then, and then that gives you another promise object, and then another promise object, and then error. So if you notice, what essentially I'm doing here is, I'm setting up a graph, right? A call graph, internally. Internally, a call graph is getting established. And basically, you can think of this as a roundabout way of setting up a try-catch block. But a try-catch block which works with asynchronous code. Now, you might be wondering, why are we talking about promises? Promises as a concept is something that has seen wide adoption in the industry. For example, if you're using jQuery, jQuery now supports promises. For example, what I could do here is, I can say return, or maybe let's not mess around with that example. So let's say I want to do here. I have a $.ajax call, right? Here I'm making a call to the Twitter service. In response to this, I want to do something else. So here what I've done, I've passed a success callback, right? You don't have to do it this way. This is the old way of doing things. In jQuery, I think probably 1.5 or up. They have added support for what are known as deferred objects, which means that instead of doing this, I can do this. I can say then a function. I'm not exactly sure what it gives. I think it gives you the XHR object. Right, maybe I'll put a debugger here. I'll put an F9 here. And I'll hit apply. Oops, just refresh that. Callback is getting called, right? And this XHR is the XHR object, right? So this is basically the exact same thing that we did earlier. In the tweets example, where I created a promise object and returned that, I created my own promise framework, right? So I'll show you that code in a bit. But here, this is part of jQuery. And now jQuery supports then, and you can do all of those things. You can say then, and you can dot error, and you can put the error handle. This is supported, I think, in prototype as well. And pretty much, this is gaining wide adoption throughout the industry. Even in Windows 8, if you want to do Windows 8 development and create desktop Windows-style applications, pretty much every single asynchronous API, asynchronous call returns a promise object. Right? So this is kind of very common now. If you think about what the promise object actually does, it shouldn't. It's not really that complicated. So let me just show you what I had. I had just put together a very rough, quick promise framework together. I'm not sure that it handles all the edge cases and whatnot, but it kind of shows you what it does. So a promise object basically, just has a few methods here, right? It obviously has a method called then. It has resolve and it has error. So when you call then on it, right, you basically are expected to pass the on resolve and on error callback. And in response to it, the key thing here is from the then object, I am in turn returning another promise object, right? So this is how you are able to set up that chain of calls. And here, what I do is, the internal implementation details don't matter. I have an internal resolve and error function which gets invoked appropriately, and in response to that I call the users function, right? So basically what happens is when you call resolve, so in my tweets.get API, once I got the response back from Twitter, I said promise.resolve, right? So when I do promise.resolve, I had saved the callback that the user had supplied in the then call, right? So that gets invoked here. The best way to figure this out is to put breakpoints in all the correct places, hit F5, and see how the control flow happens. It's not very complicated, but the idea here is it allows your code, which is asynchronous, to be much more elegant, much more sane, right? So if you're using jQuery, remember that you have this new way of doing things. You don't have to provide a success and an error callback. You can say dot then, and if you're doing more jQuery operations, you can keep chaining that as well. So that's quickly the promise framework that I want to talk about. The next framework that I want to cover is kind of more interesting. This is basically RxJS. RxJS is a composable events framework. So let's see what that is. So RxJS is a framework that kind of, we saw what promises does, right? This is like promises on steroids. It stands for reactive extensions for JavaScript. This is originally written for .NET and C#, and that has been ported to JavaScript. This is a library from Microsoft. It has direct support for many of the popular frameworks out there. Probably the best way to do is to see, kind of work through some samples and see how that actually works. It basically provides an elegant mechanism for composing asynchronous operations. It works at a different level of abstraction. Basically, the idea is there are objects which can be observed, and there are objects which are interested in observing the observable object, known as observers. Right. So this is an object which does something interesting. Right. And there are other objects which are interested in being notified of it when this object does that interesting thing. Right. So this is called an observable. That's an observer. An observer subscribes for event notifications on the observable. This thing, when that event happens, notifies the observer, right? So what RxJS does is, it basically takes this design pattern and abstracts observable objects on top of event sources. And event sources can be anything. It could be pseudo event sources of your own, right? You might generate some data from web service that can be abstracted as an observable. You might create an observable object on top of browser events. So when I move my mouse, I want to abstract that and do something in response to that, as using this framework. Now the benefit of using this framework is, there are a bunch of combinator functions which are available as part of the library, which allow you to do interesting things with these event sources, as we'll see. But the fundamental premise is this, right? There are objects which raise events, and there are objects which are interested in being notified of it when the events are raised. I have a little demo cheat sheet here. So that I don't forget to show stuff. So let me just walk you through that. Alright, so let me just get rid of all this. I shouldn't need internet after now. Okay, so I have a little console that I put together. This is, if you have attended a previous session, it's likely the same console but with support for RxJS. Let me just show you what I have done in the source here. I hope that's visible. Perhaps it's not. So that's what I have done. So you can just search for RxJS favorite search engine. You should get it. You can go ahead and download it. And the core library is basically an rx.js file which I have included in your page. And there are a few extensions that you can add on top of the base library, like support for HTML, support for jQuery, support for Dojo, prototype, and whatnot. But the base library is that. So that's all you need to do to get support for rx.js. So this particular window that you're seeing here is an eval console. Some of the things that you can do with it is you can run, write little pieces of JavaScript here, and it'll run it. So I can do that. It'll run that script. I can print stuff to a log. So I don't know. Fat fingering a lot of things today. So you can do that, and the messages show up there. I can clear the log by calling clear, and so on and so forth. So basically, I just go through some of the things that you can do with RxJS in this console, and we'll see what exactly RxJS brings to the table. So I was saying earlier that it is essentially a framework which deals with two kinds of objects, right? Observable and observers. So let's see how you can create observable objects with RxJS, right? So I can say var observable. So Rx is the global object or the namespace inside which all of the other functionalities are scoped under that. So I can go ahead and say something like this. I can say rx.observable.create, and I can provide a callback function as a parameter. Now, what is the idea here? The function that you're passing is basically the event source, right? This is the function that's going to generate the data, right? Whatever it might be. So right now we'll just to get the fundamental idea, we'll forget about the actual data that's going to be generated. We'll just hardcode some values. But this particular function is responsible for generating the event source, generating the event data that is the event source. So what you can do is, this takes one parameter, right? The Rx framework will pass an observer, somebody who's interested in being notified of this particular event, right? What you can do is, for example, I can say observer.onNext of 10, observer.onCompleted, and I'll return a function here. Now I've done three things, right? I'll explain what the last line is. But the idea is this. Whenever I have some piece of information that's available, that's ready to be sent, right? Here, let's say that information is the number 10. So I want whoever is listening to this particular event source to receive the value 10, right? How do you make that notification? On the observer, you call on next and pass the value, right? Very straightforward. And then you give another signal called on completed to indicate that your event generation is complete, right? There are no more events to be generated. And the last function is basically a way of disposing of the object which is generating events. I'll talk about that in a minute. Now, how can you use this, right? So I can do something like this. I can say observable dot subscribe, and I can basically pass an object which has all those three methods. I mean, you might be wondering, you know, what's so great about this? So I can say on next, on error. So we'll see what on error does. And you can say on completed, right? And in these three functions, what I'll do is I'll just, and here I'll say print on next, and I'll print that value. Here I'll say print on error, and whatever that error was. Here there is, you know, no data. It's just a notification that it's complete, right? And then I just run it. So on the right hand side, you can see that on next got called and on completed got called. And that's because, you know, it completed successfully. So at the root, right, this is what is happening. So when we look at more complicated examples, it might look like black magic. I mean, where is all this coming from, right? But ultimately, underneath, that's all that's happening. If there are two objects with a well-defined interface, your observer should have on next, on complete, on error. The observer will, you know, call those callbacks. Now, of course, this is a very simplistic example. You can, you can have multiple observers, right? So I can do that, and then, you know, I can create another observer here, and I call this on next 2 or something. And then you can see that, you know, both on next and on next 2 get called. So all that works, right? So if you have one observable object, you can have one or more observers. So all that works fine. But the interesting thing is, what are all the things that you can do with an observable object? Like how you can compose operations on top of that. So I'll get rid of the second observer here. What else? So this thing that I've done here, I'm just returning like one single value, right? So let me introduce the first combinator that you can do. This thing can be written simply like this. So let me just clear my log. So what I did is I just called one method called return, and I passed a single value. So again, this should be very straightforward, right? It simply does what I just did, right? It basically calls the on next on my observer, passes the value that I pass here, and on completed after that, right? Once it completes, what else can I do? I can do something like this, range of 1, 10. So now something more interesting happens here, right? So this particular function notifies the observer for a range of numbers. So when I say 1 to 10, it calls your on next from 1 to 10 and then calls on completed. So this is a very simple data source, right? It just generates a bunch of numbers given a range, right? So let's see what else we can do. So for instance, let's say I have some data as an array, right? So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So there's another variant here where you can say from array, like that. So now you can see that on next got, basically now I have created an observable object that abstracts an array as a data source. So we're just going, like, you know, in small increments. So first we abstracted over a single hard-coded piece of value called number 10. Then we abstracted over a range. Basically, you provided some input parameters and abstracted over a range of values. Now I'm abstracting over, I'm creating an observable that basically is an abstraction on top of an array, right? And the same thing works, right? You can on next and so on and so forth. The really interesting things you can, you know, start doing when you deal with other kinds of objects. For example, DOM elements, right? So what I have here is, there's another variant here called as from HTML event. So you can say from HTML event and pass two parameters to it. One is the DOM element that you are interested in. For example, I'll say document.body and an HTML event that you are interested in. For example, mouse move. So I'll say mouse move. right? Now, basically here, this observable abstracts over that, right? So basically what happens here is, whenever a mouse move event is raised, all my observers are going to get motivated. Very simple. So you can mentally visualize what is happening internally, right? So from HTML event is basically taking a DOM element, doing an add event listener on that particular element. In the handler for that, they are simply calling observer.onNext, right? So what I'll do is here I'll actually get the event object. So I'll probably say client x plus v.client1, right? Now you can see that every time I move the mouse, your event source is continuously firing. Now the point of showing you all these examples is that the core RxJS framework itself is agnostic of your event source, right? You can create your own. So these are something that are, you know, supported out of the box in the RxJS library. But if you have your own unique kinds of event sources, you can plug that in, right? And your subscriber and all that code just works. So this is interesting. So you can do this. Now some of the other cool things that you can do with this is, so let's say, so how many of you attended the functional programming in JavaScript session? About 40%. So you know you might super fast explain throttling and debouncing and all, right? That's a combinator that's supported here. So for instance, what I want to do is, I'll just copy that and refresh my page and paste that here. Alright. So what I want to do is, for example, I want to the mouse event source, maybe in response to it I'm doing something complicated. Maybe I'm doing network IO in response to every mouse move. And this is not scaling very well, right? So every time I move the mouse for every coordinate, my observer is getting notified, and my server side service is being invoked, and my server is just really struggling. So how can I, for example, maybe the solution here is to throttle the number of, the frequency at which the event source is getting raised, right? So you can do something like this. So I can say dot throttle, let's say 250, right? And now I'll just run that. So now you can see that when I move the mouse, a slightly different thing is happening here, right? Now if you notice, the only piece of code that I added is, I just continued with the Fluent API, I just said throttle, right? Everything else just works as before. Nothing changes in my observer code, nothing else changes in my source also, right? The from HTML event, nothing changes there. That code is as it is, as it was before. Basically, I have composed something on top of an event source. And it turns out that you can do this to an indefinite level, right? So, so here what is happening is, whenever I move the mouse, it is actually doing debouncing. I don't know why it's called throttling. So basically, when the time interval between two different, two consecutive events of mouse move is greater than 250 milliseconds, that's when my observer is going to get notified, right? So if I move very, very slowly, right, then for every coordinate I'm going to get, I can't move it so slowly that, it's less than 250 milliseconds. Maybe I can increase the duration here, maybe 1 second, right? But I have to refresh the page because the handler would have been bound earlier, right? So if I do it in the same page, now it will get called twice. So I'll just run this now. It's the same thing, right? So now basically the duration is more. So if I move very slowly so that it's 1 second, it's hard to show you what it does, but you get the idea, right? Basically, the duration, the time duration between two consecutive events is greater than the duration that you supplied, then your callback is going to get fired. So if I move it so fast that I get 5 events within 250 milliseconds, my callback is not going to get called 5 times. It's going to be called once that 250 millisecond is completed. So here, basically, I'm throttling the event source by a certain duration. What else can I do? Maybe I don't want this. Right. In this case, if I do a lot of mouse activity, right, maybe it's like a doodling application, I can just draw stuff, right? if I do this, then if I draw really, really fast, my user experience is going to be less than optimum because imagine that it's a collaborative computing app. It's a whiteboard in a WebEx kind of app, right? So I go and draw stuff on the whiteboard. I want other people to see it. Now, if I do this, then if I draw a lot of things, then you know the others are going to have to wait till you complete drawing. And basically, the time difference between two draw operations has to be greater than whatever iteration you give. Maybe I don't want that. I want the event source to be created once every 200 milliseconds. So that's slightly different, right? So there's another one called Sample. So I run that. So now here, when I move the mouse, you can see that slightly different behavior is happening, right? It's not happening as frequently as it happened before when I had no combinator applied at all. But it's not like the throttle case as well, right? Here, basically, every 250 milliseconds, one event goes. That's all, right? So this is called as a sampling. I think that's a better name, right? It samples your mouse move event once every 250 milliseconds. So no matter how many mouse moves I get within a 250 millisecond duration, only one event is going to go for my observer. This is different from the throttle case. The difference is slightly subtle. So if that's confusing, just experiment with it, right? Then it'll be clear. So it took a while for me to get it as well.
In this sampling thing,
there you are.
So if my mouse, I'm like, let's say drawing a curve, and there's a point here, I take the mouse here, but only these two points are sampled, so I get a straight line. So what about that? What do you do?
That's a good question. So basically, the question is, in case of sampling, right? Or in a general sense, when you sample, that's the thing with sampling, right? The question is, what happens to all the data that was generated during that interval when the callback was not propagated, right? So I've moved from point A to point B, and the browser has actually raised the event 20 times within a 250 millisecond duration. But I'm getting that notification only once. So what happens to all the coordinates which were generated during those 20 implications? So with sampling, you lose it, right?
So what, isn't the other method much better?
Throttling.
No. There was this third method.
Debouncing.
So in that library that I showed in the previous case, I handled that. So I have a debounce with data where the callback, basically it will accumulate all the information and supply that to you. So you would have to roll. So that's the thing about this library as well. So you can roll your own sample routine. Basically you can probably take that debounce function and port it over here and just roll. So all you have to make sure is that you basically return an observable. Right? You create an observable, compose over your source observable event source, implement your logic and return that observable. So you just hook into the chain. Okay. Sure. So that's those are some of the things that you can do with this. So I've just scratched the surface of RxJS here. So if you look at the, if I can find it. There it is. So when you download RxJS, you'll get a documentation like this, which is basically the complete API for RxJS. If you look at the methods that are available in observable, I've just covered what sample, range and whatnot from array management. There are a whole bunch of combinators that are available that do all kinds of fancy things. There is a time interval, there's a timeout, time stamp. There's a select many. For example, select many is an interesting combinator. What select many will do is, so if you have two event sources that are happening one after another, right? One is a mouse move, one is a mouse click, right? And you want those event callbacks to be coalesced into a single callback, right? Select many allows you to do that. So it takes two separate observable operations and it basically sequences them and makes one single callback to your observer. In fact, or take another one. Take until. Take until is a combinator, which what it does is, let's say you have two observable sequences. You want the observer to be notified from one particular sequence only so long as another observable sequence does not notify. Right. So you have two sequences, two observable objects, object A, object B, and I have an observer. I want the observer to be notified of the events generated by observable A only so long as observable B does not raise an event. Right? That's what take until some other observable. So I have a little sample here. that that shows how you can use this. I probably won't explain the sample because I wouldn't have time. But basically, this implements. Let me just show you what it does. So I have this little div over here. I can just click and drag it around. Right now, if you look at how you would have implemented it traditionally, right? So this is typically how you would have done it, right? So the object. I handle mouse down. I handle mouse move. I handle mouse up. I do all the complicated logic to implement a drag operation. Now you can do the same thing with RxJS, and the code might look a little bit more, but essentially you can see how the different combinators are being applied to do interesting things. So for example, here mouse move is the from HTML event observable on top of my object here. That is basically that particular div, the drag media. Right? I'm creating a mouse move on that. I'm creating a mouse up observable, and I'm creating a mouse down observable. Then I'm creating a composed version of that. Basically what I do is I say mouse dot skip of one. So skip is a combinator which what it will do is in a sequence of events it will skip the first one. It will skip the first one and cache it. We keep it with it. And then I compose on top of that another combinator called zip. So what zip does is, now you can see that zip is a call that is happening on top of the object that is returned by skip, right? So skip will return an observable which will have the information that was skipped. So what does that mean? So this is mouse move, right? So for the first coordinate, skip will get notified. Skip won't propagate into the next guy. That is, your zip won't get the first one. Then the second mouse move happens. Now zip is going to get notified. And skip will return the previous data as well, the mouse move that was skipped. So in zip, basically what we do is, we provide, so the context, the object on which it's being called is the observable that was skipped. And then this is the other one. This is basically the same mouse move object that's being passed here. This will have the current mouse move coordinate. It's probably, you know, getting a little confusing. What you can probably do is, you know, this is just work through it, right? So I'll share the demo. Just put some breakpoints and step through it, and you will see how this goes. Zip will take two observable objects. The one that is part of the context that is written by skip, and the other one is another observable object. And then it calls your callback and supplies those two values as two parameters to that function. So here, this basically gives me the two coordinates from two consecutive mouse moves. And then I create another composed one on top of mouse down. Here I use select menu to coalesce the two event sources. One is mouse down and one is mouse moves. Because I don't want the events to be raised when I'm simply moving the mouse. I want it to be raised only when I mouse down and then move. Right? Otherwise the dragging will keep moving when I just move, right? I want it to be dragged. So that's what this these two lines do. And then finally I do my subscriber is on top of the mouse drags. So you can see that, you know, I have a single subscriber where I, you know, do whatever needs to be done. Basically I move the div to the new location, but you can see this whole stack of the operations that have been built on top of each other, right? So the key with using RxJS is getting familiar with the list of combinators available that you can do interesting things with. So you can kind of transform your data however you like, right? You can do very, very powerful things with RxJS. And the whole thing works, right? So if you look at it here, you know, I have included that on it, right? So this is dragme.js, and this dragging is happening through RxJS. So with that, I've kind of done with the quick introduction to RxJS. Here are some resources that you might find useful. So there's a blog post on iBlog about promises. jQuery's documentation on deferred objects is pretty useful to learn about promises for jQuery. For RxJS, these are two great resources, especially the blog here by Matthew. You know how to try pronouncing the last name. So this is like a whole series of blog posts about RxJS starting from the basics. That's really useful. That's what it is. So if you have questions, you can take that. Or I think we have lunch. Any questions, promises, or this? Yeah.
How to do the custom
events? Custom what, sorry?
Custom events. How to do the custom
events? With RxJS. So the first example where I just did observable.create, and pass the function. So that's a custom event. So there I just raise pen, right? Instead of that, you can do something more interesting. For example, you might have your own web service. So maybe there you want to call that web service, get some data back, and call your context. So instead of saying observer.onNext10, you will make your Ajax call. In the response, you will say observer.onNext. So any events can be explored.
In promise framework, we created a sequence of calls using 10.
Okay.
Is there any way to distinguish the previous calls, whether it is executed successfully or not?
So if you have, if you set up a then series of calls and an error, right? If a particular then callback is being called, then that means that the previous was successful. Otherwise, your control would have gone to the error case. Even if you don't have an error case, the subsequent thens will be gone only if it's successful. If you have an error case, then you handle it elegantly, otherwise that just gets ignored. So, yeah. If you want to track other state on that, you have to do yourself. So, for example, in the previous call, I want to save some information. Then the next call, I want to use that information. That you will have to handle also. So, that's it then. Pretty much done. Thank you. Thank you.